Okay, friends, in this session, we'll try to understand what type of securities bankers take. There are various types of securities we should try to understand. First of all, let us classify these securities, because the security is obtained to fall back in case of default. It is to get our dues liquidated. For that, there could be a personal security, that is in the form of guarantor. There could be tangible security, the security of property or goods which is tangible, which you can see. Then there could be intangible security. This is a broad classification of it. Intangible security means, for example, when I am creating a charge or I am obtaining a charge of book debts, that is receivables, which you cannot see, but the security is there. So it comes under that intangible one. Then there is another classification before that. What is the principal security and what is the collateral security? Collateral security is just to fortify our dues, to make our security more strengthened. Before that, we should know what is the principal security. Principal security is a sort of asset or the security of goods, or whatever is the property which is directly funded or financed by the bank, for which the finance is being extended. That is classified as a principal security. We can say that assets against which finance is extended or finance is made to procure or acquire the same, the security of such asset is termed as a principal security, which is always used for the assessment of to what extent the finance can be extended. Then the collateral will be in addition to them, which is not directly financed by the bank. It is just to fortify our security. As a general rule, whenever a banker is required to extend finance, it's a general rule and usually it is followed also. You can say it's a practice of banking rather. It may not be the principle, it is definitely a practice of the banking. When any advance or finance is extended in the form of a term loan, that is for procurement of the fixed assets, that is land, building, plant and machinery, usually the current assets of that company, it could be in the form of stock or book debts, the charge on that current assets is taken as a collateral security to secure the term finance. And similarly, vice versa, in case of working capital finance, if it is a finance against hypothecation of stock or book debts, any working capital finance, whatever are the fixed assets of the company, the charge on those fixed assets are extended, charge is extended to cover the working capital finance. It is taken as a collateral security. So it should be very clear that the collateral security is obtained of an asset which is not directly financed by the bank. It is a collateral to the principal one. Then, as far as the banker is concerned, practical banker is concerned, or from banker's point of view, there is nothing like principal security or collateral security from the legal point of view or legality point of view. When it comes to initiating action or disposal for liquidation of our dues, so in that case, as a banker, I can exercise my right against the collateral security and I can leave aside the principal one. So as a banker, I don't make any distinction. Whatever is readily sellable, which can be readily liquidated, I can prefer it. So as a banker, from legality point of view, there is no difference between whether it is a collateral one or principal one. The rights of a banker continue to be the same in the same capacity. Similarly, from legal point of view also, there is nothing like principal or collateral. Rights of the banker remain the same. The beneficiary in whose favor the charges are created, they remain the same whether it is a collateral security or principal security. We can recapitulate: when the security in addition to the principal security is obtained to fortify advance, finance Such security is termed as collateral security. There could be immovable security, movable security, debts can be there, and even the paper securities also we obtain. Paper securities, we'll be discussing each of the type of securities. Paper securities in the form of paper, in the sense it can be national savings certificate, it can be term deposit, it can be Indira Vikas Patra or KVP or shares. It can be, it is called a paper securities. Immovable is generally land, building, plant and machinery which is embedded in the earth. Then the movables are stock, gold, gold ornaments, goods, that is movable, vehicles, furniture, fixtures and book debts. These are classified as movable. Then the paper securities consist of shares of listed company, NSCs, IVPs, KVPs, fixed deposit of the bank, even LIC policy. It could be a, what you call a paper security, and it can be a principal or as well as the collateral one. Then documents of title to goods, MTR, RR, it is in the form of paper security only. When we obtain such securities, whether it is a principal one or collateral one, as a banker, we have to take the precaution on the same footing. We cannot just say whatever the safeguards are necessary, whether I am obtaining a principal security or collateral security one, it should be precautions to be taken are with the same spirit. First, we have to see who is the owner, ownership, title to the property, even ownership of the goods is also be ascertained. Then, what is the correct valuation of the security? It's extremely necessary. Otherwise, I am getting misled. Then, whether the security is marketable or not. Marketability is also to be seen. Then, enforceability. Enforceability is a little bit legal issue. Whether I can legally enforce that security or not, these are the broad precautions to be taken. Similarly, banker, in addition to this, banker has to say that whether the person who is creating a security has a rightful owner or not. He has a right to create security, he has a right to the entitled to the property. Similarly, the property or whatever the assets are there, those should be identifiable. It cannot be imaginary. Then value of the property is also to be ascertainable. That is why we obtained the valuation report, title verification report. These are the supporting documents which facilitates in ascertaining the value of security. Then the property is sellable in case of need. And most important is, once we sell the property, property should be transferable also. If suppose you sell and you are not in a position to transfer it, then it becomes very difficult. You cannot, it's not a good security rather. When it comes to individual guarantee, because we have seen various types of guarantees, various types of securities or collaterals, here we also obtain as a security third party guarantee. Third party guarantee is an, it could be individual, it could be even the corporate guarantee also we obtain. The basic purpose of obtaining such third party guarantee is just to develop a peer pressure. It is not just a formality, because once a guarantor is taken, he stands on the same footing as a borrower. Although he has not received any consideration, the consideration is for the borrower, but as a guarantor, he is equally responsible as the borrower is responsible for liquidation of the dues. So when we obtain guarantee in their individual capacity, we have to see some sort of due diligence is required. If suppose somebody is, I am proposing some guarantor, so naturally due diligence has to be there. It is very much necessary. Then it is to be verified whether the guarantor is a willful defaulter, and definitely he enjoys good reputation in the market as well as in the society. Similarly, the worth of the guarantee is also a matter of concern, because it should not be merely token just to develop a peer pressure. The worth of the guarantor should be, it should commensurate with the exposure of a bank. Whatever the amount of exposure bank is extending, the guarantor's worth should be commensurate with that. Then, in case we are obtaining the corporate guarantee, that is of public limited company or private limited company, you have to ensure that the articles and memorandum of association of that particular company provides it empowers, because many times they are restrictive clauses. Limited company is an artificial person. They are empowered to take guarantee only if it is a regular business. But there could be some special powers given by the AGM, or the article provides it, that has to be verified before taking the corporate guarantee or guarantee on behalf of the company, whether the directors are empowered or not. Friends, many a times we are required to handle certain titling documents which are in the form of security, which are taken as a security. Just as if suppose I purchase a bill, if it is a documentary bill, naturally the title to the document, that is bill of lading or railway receipt or MTR, motor transport receipt, are the documents which conveys title on the basis of which I can take the possession of the goods. So as a banker, I have to see that the titled deeds, particularly in the form of bill of lading, railway receipt, airway bills or MTR, those are genuine, those are pakka receipts, and those are duly authenticated. Because possession of these documents, if suppose I am having a railway receipt, it affords me a right to acquire possession or custody of the goods. Because these are the provisions of the Sale of Goods Act, through which if suppose I am handing over some railway receipt, he is acquires that right to take possession, he acquires that right to take custody of the goods. So naturally the authenticity, genuineness, originality of these documents is to be seen. The documents must be negotiable. There should not be any restrictive clauses. If it is a non-negotiable document, naturally you cannot do it. Particularly it happens in case of bill of lading, because there is a separate set of non-negotiable set of document which is of no use as a banker. So we must take the negotiable document, it should be ensured. Then secondly, the goods must be paid, whatever the documents or the whatever the goods are covered, those should be adequately paid. So there should not be any right of unpaid seller. So naturally it's a very catchy situation. You have to ensure that the goods which are being sent are properly paid, so that the right of unpaid seller is also it doesn't intervene in our security. Similarly, the document must not be stale. Stale means old document. There are certain provisions, particularly in international trade. If suppose the bill of lading is 21 days old, so naturally it becomes stale. Some provisions are there. So it is to be ensured while handling this. Similarly, when we are taking anything as a security, it is to be ensured that the goods are covered by transit insurance. Here in this case, friends, we are discussing the finer issues of these things, because day in, day out, we are handling such documents, but these are to be ensured that there is a transit insurance for whatever the documents or goods I am financing. Similarly, when we are taking life insurance policy, either as a principal security or a collateral security, again, there is no distinction as per se. The policies must be fully paid. There should not be arrears of dues or premium. The policies should be assignable. That is to be confirmed, because Life Insurance Corporation issues various types of policies. Certain policies are having restrictive clauses. Those are called onerous clauses. So they restrict transferability or assignability. So in that case, those policies cannot be assigned. So that is to be seen. And the confirmation has to be sought from the LIC. Premiums are paid up to date. Policy must be original. And when I am taking a policy, so one notice of assignment has to be given to the LIC, and it must be acknowledged by them without any conditions. It should be plain acceptance that they have received the notice of assignment. Then only that assignment becomes a pakka, and the security is enforceable in that situation. Furthermore, one more issue is there. Whenever we are taking LIC policy, we need to know what is the surrender value of that policy, because it is the real value which is being taken as a principal security or as a collateral security. So surrender value has to be certified by the LIC before I accept life insurance policy as a security. Then, suppose I am taking finance or granting finance against shares, there are certain guidelines. There are certain stipulations from Reserve Bank of India also. Reserve Bank of India has prescribed certain exposure limits to all banks that they should not hold either as a pledgee or owner shares more than 30% of their paid up share capital. So this is a restrictive clause. So the finance against share must be within the exposure limit specified by Reserve Bank of India. Of course, the all corporate offices or head offices of the bank, they notify what is the exposure can be taken. In case of shares of private limited company, no finance can be extended. The finance can be extended only against the listed companies which are quoted on a notified stock exchanges. So it is to be ensured that the company is a public limited company, shares are quoted, it is listed with a stock exchange. And one more restriction is regarding the margin component. It is mandatory that while taking exposure, whatever is the average rate of market rate, the minimum margin of 50% is to be taken. It's a prescription rather. So all banks are notifying to the branches the card limit against particular shares to take care of this aspect. Then in brief, we'll discuss something about the general guidelines. When we grant loan against bank's own fixed deposit, it's not a very big thing. But two, three things are to be taken in view. You are aware that the bank's term deposit or fixed deposit, you cannot finance against the term deposit of other bank. This is number one. Secondly, the fixed deposits or fixed deposit receipts are non-transferable. So naturally, whenever I am extending finance, I get the receipt duly discharged along with the letter of lien and set off. So the fixed deposit is never transferred as a security, but it is a sort of authority with a letter of set off and appropriation, and a duly discharged receipt is handed over to the bank. Because many times it is a contract, why it should not be transferred? Because fixed deposit receipt is not transferable. It is an independent contract. So when you are taking it as a security, it should be ensured that it is discharged by the depositor as per the mandate, and it is supported by the letter of set off and appropriation. These are the precautions to be taken in case of advance against own fixed deposit. Then financing against NSCs, Kisan Vikas Patra, Indira Vikas Patra, these are various instruments issued by the post offices. Many a times these frauds are occurring in these cases also, because it's very difficult to ascertain the original one. Very typical frauds are there where even the post office shells or post office staff is also involved. Here, as a banker, what is to be ensured that all these instruments are genuine and our assignment or bank's lien is noted with the post offices before extending any finance. This is to be you should be very rigid about following this procedure. And all these things, whether it is a fixed deposit or Indira Vikas Patra or KVC, this should not be in the name of minor, because minor doesn't create any interest. So in any case, whether it is a collateral security or principal security, because of the incompetence of the minor, he cannot enter into any contract by virtue of his being minor. So all these securities should not be in the name of a minor. That is to be ensured. Then in case you are obtaining financing against gold, it's a pledge of gold. Usually, we cannot finance against the primary gold. Primary gold means the bars or it's in a raw form. So bankers are permitted to extend finance against gold jewelry. All banks are having different system. They get them evaluated through the valuer. It is again a contract of bailment. Here, the gold ornaments are handed over to the bank as a security with an intent to keep it safe rather, because ornament is a very, jewelry is a very, what you call, delicate issue. So it should be handled very carefully. Otherwise, by virtue of contract of bailment, lot of onus is on a banker. So once you what you call verifies its genuineness, its valuation. The gold ornament is a very safe finance, and it is considered as a good finance. It is considered as a good security. Usually gold document, gold ornaments are not taken as collateral security. Those are mostly in the form of principal security. Now, whatever we have discussed the various types of securities which are created, whether it is a principal one, collateral one, and all the nuances we have discussed, wherein as a banker, what sort of precaution we should take and the legal issues involved in each type of security. Thank you very much.